Amma Bad. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us into this world. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advised us to keep our connective and alive and to remember Him and to remember that we are in this world temporarily and that one day we will have to return to Him and that day will come soon. I remind myself and you therefore that we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and our connection with Him in every aspect of life. And it would be foolish indeed for one to forfeit that connection and actively choose to live in the world unhelped, unprotected and unguided. Islam is the only way in which we can maintain the connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are all born with. Every child that is born, no matter in which country, no matter in which tribe, no matter which race, no matter in which home, is born on the fitrah of Islam. And it's only their parents and their surroundings which take them away from Islam. When the Banu Nadir reneged and went back on the treaty that they had made with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they outraged the modesty of a Muslim woman, and then they killed a man who came to her aid, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam expelled them from Medina. Despite their crimes, they were permitted to leave with their movable property, their possessions, their animals, and their families. In Yathrib, before the coming of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when it became Madinatul Rasul and therefore it became Madinatul Munawwara, before this event, in Yathrib there was a period of high infant mortality among the Arabs. And a superstitious belief was formed that if the Arab children are sent to live with the Banu Nadir in their forts, that they would survive. And so there were a number of Arab children who used to live with the Banu Nadir, with the Jews in their fort. At the time of the expulsion of the Banu Nadir, the expulsion orders obviously applied also to anyone who was living with them. So the parents of those children came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam whether they were to restrain their children forcibly from leaving Medina with the Banu Nadir or whether they should permit them to go with the Banu Nadir, the families with whom they had been living. And that is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah, this famous ayah which we are all familiar with, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها والله سميع عليم. الله سبحانه وتعالى revealed, there is no compulsion in religion. Verily the right path has become clear and distinct from the wrong path. Whoever disbelieves in taghut, whosoever disbelieves in taghut, in false gods, and believes in Allah, then he has grasped the most trustworthy handhold that will never break. And Allah is all hearer and all knower. I want you to keep this term that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used, the term of the trustworthy handhold. I want you to keep this in mind as we progress in this khutbah inshallah. Just a quick reminder that this ayah, as we see from the Asbabun Nuzul of the ayah, was revealed for the people who were non-believers. It was an ayah which gave them a choice of entering Islam or staying out of Islam. The reason I am making this point is because many times there are those who like to fool themselves by misquoting this ayah because they want to live in a state of disobedience. And when somebody warns them and says, do not disobey Allah, they say, La ikraha fid din. La ikraha fid din is for the disbeliever before he or she enters Islam. Once they enter Islam, what is the position of the believer? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this very clear in the surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, آمَنَ الرَّسُولُ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ كُلُّنَا آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this very clear. The position of the believer is سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. There is no other position of the believer. Once a believer has entered Islam, then the believer says, oh, our Rabb, we have heard and we obey. There is no third position of thinking or reflecting or arguing or rebelling or considering whether one should obey a hukum of Allah Jalla wa Ala or not. A believer listens and the believer obeys. Sami'na wa ata'na, ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir. O our Rabb, we seek your forgiveness and to you is our return. Now, brothers and sisters, I remind myself and you that the Muslim is ashamed to disobey Allah Jalla wa Ala or to go against the sunnah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because to go against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam deliberately is to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Muslim does not ever do that deliberately. What happens by mistake is another matter for which we have the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He revealed the ayat with relation to what happens unknowingly or by mistake. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, La yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa wusaha, laha ma kasabat wa alayha maktasabat. رَبَّنَا لَا تُوَاخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ وَاعْفُ عَنَّا وَاغْفِرْ لَنَا وَارْحَمْنَا أَنْتَ مَوْلَانَا فَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah does not burden a person beyond his capacity to bear the burden. The person gets reward for that good which he has earned, and he is punished for that evil which he has earned. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in the dua to make. Reflect on these things, reflect on the asbab al-nuzul of this ayah. I have mentioned the asbab al-nuzul of this ayah in many of my khutbahs, and I won't repeat it here. But recall that time when this ayah was revealed and why it was revealed. And see the position of the ones who believe without questioning. Sama'na wa atana. Allah Jalla wa Ala Himself taught them how to make dua. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, oh our Rabb, do not punish us if we forget or fall into error. Our Rabb, do not lay on us a burden that you laid on those who came before us. Oh our Rabb, do not put on us a burden greater than we have the strength to bear. Pardon us and grant us forgiveness and have mercy on us. You are our Mawla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Mawla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the supporter, the protector, the patron. And give us victory over the disbelievers. Sa'ad bin Mu'adh radiallahu anhu always used to say Ameen whenever he recited this ayah. And the Mufassirin have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only taught the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in this dua, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also fulfilled this entire dua during their lifetime itself. My brothers and sisters, I remind myself and you to notice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who taught the Sahaba, did this dua, did that only when they obeyed him without question. The dua did not come before that. The dua came only when they repeated the hukum of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said to them, قُلْ سَمَعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا غُفْرَانَكَ رَبَّنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. And the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in, they did this, and that is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the last two ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah, in which this dua is included. The help and forgiveness of Allah only come to the obedient, not to those who deliberately disobey and commit sins and insist on living in a state of delusion, believing that Allah will use a different yardstick for them and will help them even if they insist on disobeying Him. May Allah fulfill their foolish dreams. I have no objection to Allah forgiving anyone. I am merely pointing out the foolishness of this belief, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Adil. Allah is just, and He will not be unjust to a slave who is obedient because somebody else insists on being disobedient. Let us be very clear in our minds. Let us not fool ourselves, because by fooling ourselves, the reality does not change. Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu narrates in a hadith in Bukhari from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said, O Mu'adh, do you know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's right is upon His slaves? And Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu said, I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul know best. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on His slaves to worship Him alone and to join none in worship with Him, Jalla wa Ala. And then he said, do you know what is the right of Allah subhanahu, what is the right of the slave upon Allah? And Sayyidina Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu said, Allah and His Nabi know best. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that if the slave does this, that is, if he worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone without ascribing partners to Him, then it is the right of the slave on Allah Jalla Jalaluhu that Allah will not punish him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish in this dunya wal akhirah. So in these ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, and I told you to remember the term handhold. And in this ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the handhold. And for those who choose the handhold, for those who choose to go against false beliefs, to go against the taghut, and those who choose to believe in Allah Jalla wa Ala, and who choose to hold the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who choose the handhold that will never break, what did Allah promise for them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allahu waliyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum minaz zulumati ilan nur walladhina kafaru awliya'uhum at-taghut yukhrijunahum minan nur ilaz zulumat ulaika ashabun nar hum fiha khalidun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah is the wali of those who believe. He brings them out of darkness into light. But as for those who disbelieve, their awliya are the taghut, the false deities and the false leaders and the false ideologies and the false thinking that they have chosen. And what does that do? They bring them out from light into darkness. Those are the dwellers of the fire, and they will abide therein forever. May Allah protect us from that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored the believers by calling Himself their wali and promise them guidance. The sign of the wilayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be guided from the darkness of shirk and kufr, from the darkness of bid'at, from the darkness of all forms of innovations in Islam, into the light of tawheed and the obedience of Allah, and into the following of the sunnah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One can measure one's own status by simply looking at one's life and actions and assessing to what extent they are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the sunnah of his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why would anyone expect the rebellious? Why would anyone accept the openly rebellious and the completely ignorant deliberately disobey the one to whom he owes everything and to whom is his eventual return? How much more do we want to live in this world in this such a disconnected way? What are we waiting for, people? Let us make our choice and do it now before we leave this masjid. Make the choice now. Do we want to have the handhold of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which will never break? Or do we want to live according to our desires? What do we want to do? Let us make this choice, inshallah, today before we leave this masjid. Yes? Because who is the one who promised this handhold? Who is the one who promised this handhold? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same set of ayat. We don't have to look even far away in the Quran. In the same set of ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us who promised this handhold. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum. لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يعوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم. This is the one who promised the handhold. What more do we want? What more do we want? What are we looking for in order to rely on Allah? What are we looking for in order to trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nobody else? Tell me, what more do we want? Because wallah, if you want something more than this, then certainly I can't give it to you. Because to me, there is nothing that is greater than the kalam of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So if this is not enough, and you want something more than this, well, I am helpless. I cannot help you. And nobody can help you. Ask yourself in your heart. Ask yourself in your heart. This is the actual word of Allah. This is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which came to us through his Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we will not believe this, then what will we believe? In the hadith of Qudsi, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quoted Allah jalla wa ala as saying, if the first and the last of you, and the living and the dead among you, those of you who are young and those of you who are old, were all gathered on one plane, each one of you asking all that he could ever hope for, and if I were to grant the request of each and every one of you who asked, that would not decrease what I have in my dominion any more than a needle decreases the ocean when it is put in it and removed. Hey? See the shan of Allah. What can we do if our hearts are shut to that shan of Allah? What can we do if the heart is closed and sealed? May Allah protect us from the sealing of the hearts. May Allah open our hearts to His glory and His majesty and to His noor. See the shan of the kalam of Allah Jalla wa'ala. What is Allah saying? What is the meaning of the hadith? This means that if every human being and every jinn, from the first one who was created to the last one who will be created before the day of judgment, including all the kings and all the presidents and all the rulers, including all the anbiya, including Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if all of them together were gathered on one plane, and if every single one of them asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every conceivable thing that comes into their minds, every single thing, and if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave all of them all of that in one instant, this would not decrease from the treasure of my Rabb even as much as the water that comes on the drop of a needle if it is dipped into an ocean. Even to that extent, it does not decrease the treasure of Allah. Why do we live in fear? I've said this so many times. Why do we live in fear? How can fear enter the heart of somebody when the heart is filled with the Tawheed of Allah? How can fear enter the heart of somebody whose heart is illuminated by the glory of Allah Jalla Wa'ala? How can we ask anyone other than Allah when we know there is Allah? How can we ask anyone other than Allah when we know that no one can give us anything more than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes? How can we ask anyone other than Allah when we know that that person is a faqir, that person himself is muhtaj, that person himself has no power and no authority even to do something for himself? How can that person help us? How can that person help us? When the person cannot even do something for himself, the person cannot choose to be born when he is not born, the person cannot choose not to die when the time for death comes, the person cannot choose not to be sick when sickness comes, the person cannot choose to be cured before the cure is decreed by Allah, the person cannot choose to be strong when weakness is decreed by Allah, the person cannot choose to be weak when strength is decreed by Allah, the person cannot choose to be wealthy when poverty is declared by Allah, and the person cannot choose poverty when wealth is decreed by Allah. The person cannot choose to see when Allah has chosen to take away his sight. The person cannot choose not to see when Allah chooses to give him sight. I can go on ad infinitum, but I think the matter is clear. How can we have fear when we recognize all of this? So if we still have fear, then we must ask, do I really recognize this or not? My brothers and sisters, on the authority of Abu Dharr Ghifari radiallahu anhu, in another hadith Qudsi, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quoted from Allah Jalla wa ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, see the majesty of this kalam, subhanallah, ajib. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O my slaves, I have forbidden oppression on myself and have made it forbidden amongst you, so do not oppress one another. O my slaves, all of you are astray and misguided except for those I have guided, so seek guidance from me and I will guide you. O my slaves, all of you are hungry except for those I have fed, so seek food from me and I will feed you. O my slaves, all of you are naked except for those I have clothed, so seek clothing from me and I shall clothe you. O my slave, you sin by night and by day, and I forgive all sins, so seek forgiveness from me and I will forgive you. O my slaves, you will not be able to harm me or to benefit me. O my slaves, were the first of you and the last of you, the human of you and the jinn of you, to become as pious as the most pious heart of any of you, that would not increase my kingdom in anything. And O my slaves, were the first of you and the last of you, and the human of you and the jinn of you, to become as wicked as the most wicked heart of any of you, that would not decrease my kingdom in anything. O my slaves, were the first of you and the last of you, the human of you and the jinn of you, if you were to rise up in one place and make a dua of me, make a request of me, and were I to give everyone what he requested instantaneously, that would not decrease what I have any more than a needle decreases the sea if put into it and taken out. O my slaves, it is but your deeds that I reckon up for you and then recompense you for. So let him who finds good praise Allah, and let him who finds other than that blame no one but himself. Both of these ahadiths are narrated are in Ibn Majah and Tirmidhi and in Muslim Sharif. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِهُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير تولج الليل في النهار وتولج النهار في الليل وتخرج الحي من الميت وتخرج الميت من الحي وترزق من تشاء بغير حساب. This is the majesty of our Rabb, and I ask him to fill our hearts with it, so that the greatness of everything else disappears. So as I was saying, the topic of today's khutbah is become a wali of Allah. And that is what this whole khutbah is about. How do we become awliya Allah? How can we become the awliya of Allah? So what is the benefit of being a wali of Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned his awliya in the Quran in Surah Yunus. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ لَهُمُ الْبُشْرَى فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. الله سبحانه وتعالى said, no doubt, verily the awliya of Allah, no fear shall come upon them, nor shall they grieve. They are those who believe in Islam and have taqwa. For them are glad tidings in the life of the present world and in the hereafter. And no change there can there be in the word of Allah. And this indeed is supreme success. To be the wali of Allah is supreme success. Now the first thing to understand in these ayats, which incidentally are among the most misunderstood and misquoted ayat of the Quran, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defined who his awliya are. So firstly, let me define the term wali as referred to in the Quran. The term wali is mistakenly translated as friend, and you will find this in all sorts of translations. In the Urdu translation, they say Allah ka dost. And in English translation, they say friend of Allah. The term grammatically is correct. Wali means friend in the Arabic word, in the Arabic language. Actually, there are many words for friend. Rafiq is also friend, Zamil is also friend, Wali is also friend. So Khalil is also friend, different levels of friendship. But since we have languages which are impoverished and we have only one word friend, and therefore we translate everything as friend. So first of all, that's a major problem with the translation of the Quran. Second important point to understand is that as in many other words, a word may have a grammatical meaning, but in the istilah of the Quran, in the technical terminology of the Quran, the word has a different meaning. For example, the word salah means dua. Salah means dua. But if somebody takes aqimus salah as saying establish dua, therefore I am making dua, I need not pray. Now, what do you say about that person? You can say many things, which I don't want to say here. But let me make it very clear, if you do not pray, then you are going to be in a hot place for a long time. So there are istilahi ma'ana of the Quran, and there are the lughwi ma'ana of the Arabic word. Similarly, the word wali, the lughwi ma'ana, the dictionary meaning is friend, but the istilahi ma'ana, the technical meaning in the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is a person who is loved by Allah, a favorite slave of Allah. Please do not equate friendship as we have friends between each other. Friendship means equality, friendship means lack of takalluf, friendship means that there is no adab between the two. Not with Allah. Not with Allah. Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has his level and his position. The slave can never reach the position of Allah. Let us be absolutely clear in our minds about this. Fana fillah is the Arabic meaning, Arabic translation of Advait, which is a Hindu philosophy. Nothing to do with Islam.
Somebody who says he is gone in Allah, and therefore Al-Hallaj and Sufi Sarmast and Dewan, they said inside this Mishla is only Allah. And then they separated his head from his body and they found there was no Allah, there was him. This is all shaitan. Shaitan takes you to a place which is a bad place. There is no fana fillah. There is only fana. Right? Kullu man alayha fan. There is only fana. There is no fana fillah. So let us be prepared for our own fana. Don't bring Hindu philosophy into Islam and consider it to be Islam. It is not Islam. It is Hindu philosophy. The wilayat of Allah is to reach a position, and may Allah grant us all that position, where we become the favorite slaves of Allah. When Allah will love us, we are still slaves. But how do we reach that position of being the favorite slave of Allah? By being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, we have to understand this word friendship in the context of the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, so what is this issue about being the favorite slave of Allah? As I said, my brothers and sisters, this has to do with being obedient to Allah. Please understand, knowledge alone does not benefit. It's only knowledge which is practiced that benefits. You might know all about tahajjud. You might know all about the descent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala onto the first heaven at the time of tahajjud. You might know all about the announcements which are made on at that time about the acceptance of dua. You might be the global expert on this. You might write a 5,000 page book on this. But if you don't pray two rakat of tahajjud, you will not benefit from that. It's as simple as that. Tatajafa junubuhum anil madaji yad'una rabbahum khawfan wa tama'a wa mimma razaqnahum yunfiqun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Sajda, he said about the people who pray tahajjud, he said they get up from their sides, they get up from their beds in that part of the night, and they stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bayna al-khawfi wa tama'a, between the fear of Allah and hope from Allah. Until we do that action, knowing about tahajjud will not benefit us. I'm saying this because let us understand, knowing about wilayat of Allah will not make us awliya. Working to become a wali of Allah, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, we ask Allah to make us among his awliya and to count us among his awliya. Now, who are these awliya? In a hadith that is narrated in Muslim, Bukhari, Muwatta Imam Malik and Tirmidhi, on the authority of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, who quoted from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the meaning of the hadith is, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, if Allah loves a slave of his, he calls Jibreel alayhi salam and says, by name, I love so and so. And then he, Jibreel alayhi salam, calls out in the heavens and says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves so and so. I want you to think about this. I want you to put your own name in that. What is the value of Jibreel alayhi salam announcing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves Zahir? What is the position of Jibreel alayhi salam announcing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves Abu Bakr? I mean this one sitting here. That one we know Allah already loves him. You're talking about this one here. And his brother up behind him, Hamza. What is the value of that? Bring it into your life. Unless you bring this into your life, unless you realize the value of this, you will not have appreciation for it. What is the value of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calling Jibreel and saying, I love so and so. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Jibreel salam announces this in the heavens. And then he said that acceptance therefore and love for that person is established in the inhabitants of the heavens, which is the malaika, and acceptance for that person and love and izzat for that person is established on the earth. And conversely, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes a slave of his, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from this. He calls Jibreel alayhi salam and announces and says, I dislike so and so. And Jibreel alayhi salam makes this announcement in the world and says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates so and so. And the hatred for that person and the dislike for that person is established among the inhabitants of the heavens and the earth. Let us remember, especially those of us who are so concerned about the opinion of others and popularity among the people, utterly useless though it is, that only the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves can have real popularity and izzah. For all others, the izzah that they see, the popularity that they see, is momentary, dependent on mutual benefit, and disappears as soon as your ability to do something for those people declines. The moment you leave a position of authority, they won't even answer your phone call. All those who used to run around you like flies around a lamp, when you call them, they will not even pick up your phone call. This is the reality of life. This is the reality of life. Some people learn this the hard way and are very surprised when they find themselves dumped by those who used to chase them when they were in power. Finally, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admits a person into his wilayat, then he declares war on anyone who troubles him. On the authority again of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, who said and quoted from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whosoever shows enmity to my wali, I will be at war with him. My slave does not draw near to me with anything more beloved by me than the faraid that I have made fard on him. And my slave continues to draw closer to me by the nawafil, by the voluntary works. I have said this many times before. Fard is fard. You leave the fard, then you are in serious trouble. But to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to do more than fard. Same rule applies to our lives in this world also. A soldier gets a medal for doing something over and above the call of duty. He gets a salary for doing his duty. Doesn't get a medal. He gets a medal for doing something more than his duty. And with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the nawafil which take us close to Allah. And if someone misunderstands this and say and leaves the fard and does nafil, well, that is crazy. The fard is the doorway through which we enter the building, enter the room. So faraid are fard. And after that, it is the nawafil, it is the tahajjud, it is the azkar, it is tilawatil Quran, it is the khairat and sadaqat, not the zakat. The zakat is fard, beyond the zakat. It is all of those things which take us closer and closer to Allah, and we ask Allah to make us close to Him by these means. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that my slave continues to draw near to me with voluntary works, with nawafil, until I love him. And when I love him, I am his hearing with which he hears. I am his seeing with which he sees. I am his hand with which he strikes, and his foot with which he walks. Were he to ask something of me, I would surely give it to him. And were he to ask refuge and protection, I would surely grant it to him. I do not hesitate about anything as much as I hesitate about taking the soul of my wali, because he hates death and I hate to hurt him. Now, brothers and sisters, I remind myself and you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared war on only two people: those who eat riba and those who trouble his awliya. Only two people on whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared war: those who deal with interest and those who trouble his awliya. In conclusion, I remind myself and you that the only goal worth striving for is to become a wali of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his infinite mercy, made it easy for everyone to attempt this. To be a wali of Allah, it is not necessary to be a hafiz of the Quran or a mufassir of his kalam, or to be a muhaddis, or to be an alim of hadith, or to be a doctor or an engineer or a rocket scientist. To be a wali of Allah, it is only necessary to believe in Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and to develop taqwa in our lives. Iman wa taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those who have iman and those who have taqwa. Iman is the belief, taqwa is the expression of that belief. Iman is the belief,
Taqwa is the action which shows and proves that this belief exists. As long as a person has the belief and the person shows that he has this belief by showing his taqwa, by having his taqwa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, insha'Allah, will enter him into the list of his awliya. What daraja Allah gives to someone is up to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not reveal this ayat for us to designate so and so as a wali of Allah, and then to say that he is a wali of Allah, and this other one is a bigger wali of Allah, and he is, and so and so is the biggest wali of Allah. All of these statements are statements of ignorance. All of these statements are to speak about the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge. And this is the Ummul Qaba'is. It is the mother of all evil. To speak about the kalam of Allah without knowledge is the mother of all evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named his anbiya. And therefore, we can say the name of somebody and say so and so was a nabi of Allah, as long as that person is one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named Nuh alayhi salam, and Musa alayhi salam, and Isa alayhi salam, and Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sabi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named them, and we can say so and so was a nabi of Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not name any of his awliya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say so and so has a daraja bigger than so and so. And therefore, for anyone to make that statement, for anyone to say that so and so is a wali of Allah, is haram. It is something which the person has no right to do. It is prohibited. It is the worst of ignorance. And it is something which we should keep ourselves very far from. Insha'Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made every Muslim on the face of the earth, as long as they have iman and taqwa, there Allah has made all of them his awliya. Who are you and I to deny people what Allah has given them? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made all of you his awliya, how can I say that you are not his wali and that someone else is his wali? Can I say that? I cannot say it, I do not say it. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you all his awliya. Because insha'Allah, all of you are people of iman. And insha'Allah, all of you are people of taqwa. Now what we need to do is to increase our taqwa, into increase our iman in such a way that we get darjat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us be very, very clear about it. It is important, it is something, the wilayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something that an illiterate poor person can achieve as easily and as well as a rich scholar. There was a man by the name of Bishr al-Hafi, rahmatullah alayhi, at the time of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahmatullah alayhi, and Imam Ahmad was one of the greatest scholars of his time. And Imam Ahmad used to say about Bishr al-Hafi, he used to say, Al-Bishr is my ustad. And people came to him, somebody objected and they said, how do you call Bishr al-Hafi your ustad when he does not know so many ahadith? And Imam Ahmad himself was reputed to know more than 125,000 ahadith. And remember, when we say hadith, we don't mention the Quran, because somebody who knows 125,000 ahadith, we know that automatically that person was a hafiz of the Quran anyway. That is where it all begins. So people came and they said, how do you call him your ustad when he does not know as many ahadith as you do? And Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahmatullah alayhi said, Bishr knows Allah, whereas I know hadith. Now this is also the inkisar, this is also the humility of the scholar. This does not mean that Imam Ahmad did not know Allah. But I'm saying that he talked about this, he said, what does it show? It shows that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it easy for us. Imagine if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that to be a wali of Allah, firstly you have to be hafiz of the Quran. What will most of us do? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rahmanur Rahimu fi dunya wal akhirah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make all these conditions. All he said is have iman and have taqwa. Whatever knowledge we have, inshallah we should try to seek more and more knowledge. There's nothing wrong with that. Alhamdulillah is very good for us. But Allah has not made this a condition, so we need not make it difficult on ourselves. If Allah did not make the condition, why do you make it a condition? Why do you say anything? Alhamdulillah, every Muslim who has iman and who has taqwa is a wali of Allah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to include all of us among that.
And what did we say? What is the benefit of being a wali of Allah? That your dua is accepted. That your dua is accepted. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, mentioned in the Hadith al-Qudsi, that if my slave, if my wali asks me, I will give him. So when you make dua, make dua with this feeling, with this understanding, with this ihtizal, and say, oh Allah, you said I am your wali. Because you said you are my wali. Because you said, Allahu wali ulladhina amanu. And oh Allah, I have iman on you. Oh Allah, I'm asking you, ya Allah, give me. Make dua with this istihzar of this ilm. Make dua with this understanding that this is the deen. This is this beautiful deen which connects the slave directly to his Rabb. Sal jalla jalla wa ala. And that is the reason why, my brothers and sisters, I remind myself and you to let us live with this understanding. And let us live with this clarity in our minds that inshallah, if we want to become the awliya of Allah, it is very simple. We develop iman and we develop taqwa, which means that we become obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us without question, and we follow the sunnah of His Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and inshaAllah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will include us among His awliya. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to include all of you among His awliya. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all your du'as and to fill your lives with khair, to be pleased with you, to mention you on His arsh, to announce to the world, to Jibreel alayhi salam, that all of you, that He loves you, to announce to Jibreel alayhi salam that He loves all of you individually by name. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to decree that Jibreel alayhi salam announces to the whole of creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves each one of you by name. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He establishes your izzah, He establishes your love for you and for all your families everywhere in the world, wherever they might be. That I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you by His power and to protect you by His majesty, to fill your hearts with His noor, that when you see by His sight, when you hear by his samat, that when you walk with His power, and when you hold and when you raise your hand in the establishment of justice, that you do that with His quwwat and His izzat. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajmain bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.